cell industry, ethics was one of the biggest topics that we talked about. We had all kinds of task force and position papers, and it seems to have really died down as we've taken a stance about how we feel about the ethics of neuroscience and neuromarketing, and it's come to be accepted that we go against certain guidelines and is therefore trusted. But now with AI coming into the whole realm, it's a whole new ballgame again, and so I'm very curious to hear what you have to say. Thank you.
I appreciate your time here today as I talk about ethical AI data capture and the monetization of biometric data sets. It's a pleasure to speak with you here today in Los Angeles. I called LA home for a time in my younger years, and during that time, I especially enjoyed the arts, like painting. This is a photo of me with a painting of mine featured at the local Bartlesection Arts in North Hollywood. And while I pursued painting, I would support myself financially with all types of work, either as a waiter at an empty soul food restaurant in Noho, or as a sales assistant in boutiques like Sonoma or Bale Drive. My favorite of all my roles was teaching. I taught English both online and abroad, and while teaching, came across the concept of machine learning. And it posed this question: how much benefit could machine learning bring to education on a global scale? The potential benefit this technology can have in people's lives took me on a path into the world of data science. And so I explored machine learning models through self-study courses and boot camps until in 2019, when I developed TAI, the online teacher's assistant AI, for an online English company I worked for at the time. This system of models used Microsoft Azure's suite to translate for the foreign language instructor when a student may have used their primary language. The system could also output probability scores for student learning and engagement. The system could even offer real-time suggestions for activities to boost student comprehension, and make learning reports for students and parents. After developing this prototype, I continued to explore generative artificial intelligence, and in 2020, I was studying at the Flatiron School, Data Science School, and was particularly interested in how this technology might impact diversity and inclusion in media. And so I worked on a system of models that could generate lifelike faces and then match these faces onto the faces of people in the original content. And at the time, this idea was a bit more novel and referred to as deepfake, so I made a brief introduction for the idea, and I'd like to share it with you now. So we should be having a video playing. We'll have to skip that. So the video essentially describes my perspective on how this technology can be used to make customized experiences in learning, in film, and television. And I think that I could have got across to my audience. So I broadcast that video and conducted a survey, and here's some of the results. So I feel these demographics show some healthy diversity in groups like age and ethnicity. And so when asked which people prefer for online learning between a traditional system only, a system that's traditional with AI augmentation and AI only, people wanted the option for both original content and AI generated content, more on average. As well, when asked which they prefer for movies and television shows, people seemed to prefer a combination of original content and AI-generated content for their film and television shows, while there was some preference for AI-only systems and ads. Now, I noticed that many people people were interested in augmenting their favorite television shows and movies, with several wanting to see themselves or loved ones represented in their content. So you can imagine movie night with your family, and maybe tonight someone gets to play the hero and someone else gets to play the villain. This idea was quite interesting to people. Overall, 83% of the respondents felt that this technology could promote diversity and inclusion in media. And I found this work fascinating. I felt that there was something transformative on the horizon, something that could bring more fairness into people's lives if it were used effectively. And so now we kind of fast forward to today where we see some interesting results from diversity and inclusion. For example, in the last month, Google released a model named Gemini, which was cutting edge, but it could not output images of people of a certain race when prompted. It also cannot generate historically accurate images of the founding members of the U.S. To this, Google co-founder Sergey Brin is quoted to have said, "We definitely messed up on the image generation, mostly due just not to thorough testing." This showcases even more the importance of understanding the interaction between AI models, people, and our culture. So I continued to work as an instructor and focus on teaching and developing curriculum for data science and machine learning. And then in 2022, I began DData Labs. We are an AI and biometrics lab based in Atlanta, Georgia. And based on that previous work and vision, we want to incorporate consent and compensation for the use of a person's Gen AI data. So what does that mean? I can describe it in terms of a formula where we can combine AI with a person's biometric data in a way that educates them, that entertains them, earns for them, and overall empowers them. So I'd like to start with that first term, the AI term. Here I'm referring to deep learning in general, and more specifically, generative artificial intelligence. So while there are many deep learning models that can do amazing things, perhaps the most famous, of course, is ChatGPT, many people consider what makes the model so effective at generating the desired output is that it was fine-tuned on human preference data. Its architecture is an example of reinforcement learning with human feedback, or RLHF. So this is a diagram from OpenAI's paper, Learning to Summarize from Human Feedback. And in it, they detail the process of fine-tuning a model to summarize text more effectively. So the authors began with posts from the Reddit Too Long Did Not Read dataset. They then have various baseline models or policies to create summaries about these posts. Each of these policies focusing to varying degrees on different aspects of the post, like key facts or natural flow. Now the next part is very important. They then present these summaries to a group of human evaluators who judge the summaries for their quality on a number of factors. This is the human input. Next, after several rounds, they have the posts and these summaries, and they use that as data to train a reward model that can calculate a grading system where the higher the reward is assigned to a summary, the more likely that summary is seen to be aligned with human preference. And so these reward values are then used to train the policy further, teaching it the patterns within human preference by positively reinforcing the higher reward summaries and negatively reinforcing those lower reward summaries. And this process is repeated and repeated until the model is able to output summaries that are more often preferred to human written summaries. And so this is another visualization from the same paper. Here, we're measuring the difference in performance between a few different OpenAI models. Our y-axis is just the percent of time that the summaries from that particular model is preferred to human written reference. So here at the bottom, we can see the pre-trained only V models. These are the summaries from the early GPT models, lowest performing. Above this in green, we can see supervised models that the summaries from supervised models that were fine-tuned on 117,000 human-written too long did not read summaries. And up above this reference line, in orange, we have the summaries from the human feedback model that was further fine-tuned on 65,000 cases of RLHF summaries. So I share these results with you just to demonstrate the value that human feedback has in optimizing generative artificial intelligence models and how it's important for producing desired outcomes. So that gets me to my next term of the equation, biometrics. At GData Labs, we are testing biometric data as a form of human feedback for RLHF and similar processes. We find that training AI models on various biometric data can enable them to better understand human values. And so this idea has led our team to conduct a number of exploratory studies, which while they have remained small, do involve electroencephalogram, facial expression analysis, galvanic skin response, and eye tracking. One such study was conducted with iMotions at their headquarters in Boston in 2022. Our methodology was to ask 9 participants to describe their ideal personal space, their ideal vacation location, and their ideal meal. We then used these descriptions as prompts for a text-to-image model named Stable Diffusion version 1.4, and had the model output 5 images for each prompt. Here's an example of a set of images made from a person's description of their ideal personal space. It's described as a space with a comfortable chair, a big window with opportunity of fresh air, a view of a body of water and trees. So we then use the biometric devices to measure the person's response to these stimuli. Now, from the top left to the bottom center, we can label these images as 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So I'd like to invite you all to consider which image you prefer or which you feel best fits the description of the prompt. Would anyone care to share their opinion with a show of fingers? Okay, I see a lot of twos. Okay, well, if you chose one in the top left, you agree with the participant. When analyzing our eye tracking heat map data, we found that gaze was a nice predictor for a preference. It seemed that our participants would put more attention toward the image that they preferred. Since then, we've been able to layer on video and audio onto these preferred images. And I'm not sure if this will play, but we can give it a try. Okay, so I have my audio playing, and this is the video playing. This video is generated from Runway ML's Gen 2 model, where we're just able to feed in the image from the model, for the model to kind of generate a video, and that audio was created from the prompt for 11Lab sound effects. Here are some of the preferred images for ideal vacation location. They definitely look like nice places to visit for me. Do you notice any patterns and things like color or location? Well, we noticed within our galvanic skin response data that when people observed the preferred images for vacation location, there was a lower peak count in skin conductance compared to the ideal meal and ideal personal space question. This seemed to suggest that maybe these ideal vacation location images would have less arousal on the participant, maybe induce more relaxed state. Here are some of the preferred ideal meal images. You may notice here AI's rendition of a pill that you can take that will give you all of your body's nutritional needs for a month. when we analyzed the facial expression data, we found that when people were observing the preferred images for ideal meal, they showed an increase in the amount of time that they had a sentimental kind of expression. This suggested to us that potentially observing images of their ideal meal induced positive memories. We also used EEG to capture frontal alpha asymmetry data, and we calculated the Z-score for this so that we can have a measure that's more comparable between people and between questions. And we found that there was a higher average for the Z-score for FAA with the preferred images compared to the non-preferred images. This could suggest that these images maybe induce a more positive affective state for the participant. So at G Data Labs, we're finding that AI and biometrics is a beneficial partnership. We collect human preference data to train AI models to produce more desirable outcomes, not only in a general sense, but also in a personal and individual level. I think this is one of the unique values that neuromarketing can bring to the AI space, and the value of human preference data, I think, will only continue to grow over time as these models are more integrated into our lives. Admittedly, there are still many big challenges with AI if we're to have a safe, effective, and beneficial adoption. We have the jobs issue, the copyright concern, the AI alignment problem, and public distrust, just to name a few. When I consider that all those roles that I have, both past and present, may be replaced by AI within the next amount of years, I consider how people will be able to support themselves financially in light of this technology. There's current litigation against companies like Microsoft and Google over using data to train Gen AI models without express permission or compensation. And perhaps most concerning of all is the AI alignment problem. These models need to be aligned with our values for use in certain applications like healthcare or energy, as there can be a number of undesirable outcomes. So to learn more about the jobs issue, my team and I visited LA last year to observe the SAG-AFTRA strikes in Rosemont. There are a number of protests going on across town at all the big studios, and we came to find that many people were protesting the use of Gen AI to replace them in various stages of the production for movies and television shows. Still, some wanted to protest the use of an artist's previous work to train a model, and others were protesting for protecting their consent on how their data might be used to train a model, such as a model maybe putting their image in a scenario they didn't approve or augmenting their image in some way. I have a video here, I don't think it's gonna play, but this is of Brian Cranston. He really captured the energy of these protests, the anger that the artists felt about being replaced by AI just for a cheaper product by the execs. So we conducted a set of interviews at the protest, and again, due to that public distrust, our results are quite small. Many people did not want to be put on record during the protest, but the results that I do have to share today, I feel, do capture the overall sentiment of the group that we talked to. And we found that there was strong polarity in the opinion for artists to sell their personal data to train AI models. This bar plot shows that more people were interested and more comfortable in sharing their browsing history, social media data, facial expression analysis data, and EEG data to train AI models, and less comfortable about selling their eye tracking, audio capture, and their heart rate count. From one representing most negative and five representing most positive, we found that overall there was more negative sentiment toward AI at the time of the protest. But we found when asked if a person should have the right to sell their personal data to train AI, AI, 80% of those respondents felt that that person should. And likewise, when asked if a person should have to give explicit consent for the sale and use of their data to train AI models, 100% every person that we talked to felt like we should have that right. Since the SAG-AFTRA protest, there's been an agreement between the artists and the studios. The agreement definitely focuses on artist consent and compensation. This is something that we found common thread throughout our interviews, and it deeply aligns with those results. I've been studying this agreement, and I feel that there are many trends that are going to migrate to other fields as well. So this is one of the executives of a studio based in Atlanta, Tyler Perry. When he observed some of these results from OpenAI's Sora model text to video, it motivated him to shut down a four-year-long $800 million expansion he was planning in Atlanta. He also acknowledged that he'd already used AI to produce aging effects in two of his previous films. So, at GData, we are developing a platform that integrates informed consent, granular consent, and personal data valuation as a viable solution to some of these looming issues in AI. So when I say informed consent, I'm meaning consent given with a confirmed understanding of one's agreement and the legal and socioeconomic implications. When I refer to granular consent, I'm talking about someone being enabled to choose the use cases for different types of their data. And with personal data valuation, a person is able to set some type of monetary value to the data that they upload on our platform. Much like a stock exchange, they'll have to negotiate with the buyers of their data. On our platform, a person can interact with generative AI models that produce text and image consumed, video and audio, and they can record these interactions to collect facial expression analysis data, audio capture, and eye tracking for sale. And the buyers of this data will use that data to train AI models to produce more desired output for their consumer base. By enabling granular consent, a person is able to collect other personal data points about themselves, anything from their emotional state that day. They can just upload their images, and artists can even upload data related to their performance and set consent restraints to how that data may be used. We also integrate LLMs and other generative models for informed consent, such as on our terms and conditions site. We can use LLMs to translate some of these legalese terms for someone to make sure that they understand what they're agreeing to. And our future work involves fine-tuning these models to match the person's reading level and writing style. And lastly, on our GData Market Exchange, a person can declare or appraise their data and set a value to negotiate for the sale and use of that data. And our transactions cannot occur unless both parties agree to the use case. We want people to be educated, entertained, and empowered by their interaction with AI. And to that end, our future work involves showcasing the capabilities of current Gen AI models and capturing data related to the interaction in real time. We want to use this data to fine-tune our own GData models in the future that are hopefully more aligned with human values. Overall, our long-term goal is to develop a global community of people that are able to financially support themselves through the sale of their personal data. team for all the work that they've done and helping me toward that goal in GDOT Labs. Your work is invaluable. And I'd like to thank you all for your attention and time today. I'd like to open the floor to any of your questions. Thank you.